Dobar dan svima. Prvi put smo sa vama u ovom formatu i mnogo smo srećni što seriju intervjua sa našim autorima, sa autorima naših knjiga, počinjemo upravo sa Patrikom Eginisom, autorom knjige FOMO, Strah od propuštanja. Seriju intervjua možete pratiti na našem kanalu, a mi jedva čekamo da ga upoznamo sa vama i njegove principe i kako da donosite odluke u svetu prepunom izbora. Ja sam Lidija, ovo je Danica i ona će nastaviti ovaj razgovor i voditi Patrika kroz pitanja. Zdravo svima, ja sam Danica. Ono što želim sa vama da podelim jeste sledeće. Deo našeg uređivačkog posla jeste da se upoznamo sa likom i delom autora, a Patrik McGinnis je zaista jedna fascinantna ličnost. Pre svega on je jedan neustrašivi preduzetnik koji posluje na čak četiri kontinenta i zaista je sjajan autor. Ja se nadam da ćete tome uskoro i sami posvedočiti, a pored toga je izvanredan govornik. Ono što je fascinantno kod njega jeste to što nesebično deli svoje iskustva i iz njih izvlači neke, da kažemo, lekcije i principe koje će, opet kažem, podeliti sa nama. A nas i naš tim je najviše impresioniralo ono što ćemo ćete uskoro posvjedočiti sami, a to je to što je on tako otvoren i prizeman i pristupačan čovjek. I eto, danas se nadam da će biti, da će nam odgovoriti na sva ona naša pitanja koja smo pripremili. Ne bismo li vam približili zapravo sam fear of missing out fall. Ok, so, good morning, Patrick. It's morning, at your home, yeah?
Yeah, it is. Thank you.
So, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. Very good. How are you?
We are great. Yeah. We are so happy to have you here. And really, thank you for your time. We are true fans over here. We find your podcast truly inspiring. And but most of all, what I need to emphasize is that we enjoyed preparing your book, Fear of Missing Out, for the Serbian market.
So much.
Yeah, this book is so insightful. And it really makes you reconsider all of your behavioral patterns, yeah? And it actually encourages us to face our fears, but what's on the top of it, we really cherish and really love your brilliant humor that really makes this whole process of introspection so, so much easier. So without further ado, we already explained what the acronym FOMO stands for, so fear of missing out, but who is FOMO Sapiens?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me. It's an honor to be launching the book in Serbian. I'm so thrilled. Serbia, would you believe I've been to 103 countries and I haven't been to Serbia yet? And Serbia is on the, and I have very good friends in Belgrade. So I really am looking forward to coming maybe this summer, who knows? So what is a FOMO Sapiens? Well, I've really changed my thinking on that. I used to think that a FOMO Sapiens was somebody who was so overwhelmed that they couldn't do anything because they couldn't choose between the many opportunities in their life. I have come to believe now, having this podcast, FOMO Sapiens, that a FOMO Sapiens is somebody who recognizes that there are many choices in life and then lives decisively so that they can do the many things they want to do, but in a thoughtful way. So a FOMO Sapiens can be a good thing. In fact, a lot of successful business people, successful people in life are FOMO Sapiens because they understand what FOMO is. They accept the fact that we live in a time where FOMO is everywhere, but they choose to live decisively.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. So, you cannot always get what you want. And that's something that made sense a half of century ago, yeah? So what about today? Is that something that FOMO Sapiens can truly understand?
It's really true what you say about, 50 years ago, you had the Rolling Stones, right, talking about this. And then nowadays, it does kind of feel like you can get what you want because if you think about it, like I was just doing my taxes and going through my all of my credit card charges for 2020, where we were all in quarantine most of the year. And basically the only two things that I spent money on, sadly, were Uber Eats and Amazon, because anything I want to buy, I could find. I live in New York City. We have thousands of restaurants. On Amazon, you can buy anything you want. Amazon is so much larger than your typical store that you could visit in your community. So we have become spoiled to think, because we go on Netflix and there's so much content, because we go on the internet and we can find any answer to any question we have, we have become spoiled to thinking that we can have what we want at all times. But of course, the problem with that is that unless you know what you want, you can never have what you want. And that's where all these problems start.
Yeah, you're right. Yes, and the freedom of choice has never been more guaranteed, but somehow some of us cannot even make a choice. What is the reason? What do you think?
So I think it's a couple of different things. One of the things that happens when we think about our choices is that we don't know what we truly want. We haven't taken the time to think about what it is we want, and we're making decisions based on external things, what other people are doing or what looks good. You know, if you think about it, you go on Instagram and you see your friend at a restaurant, you know, they've taken this beautiful photo and posted it, and it may or may not correspond to reality, but you have the perception that there's something great out there. And at the same time, you're also getting this idea that everybody's doing something but you, that there's a herd out there that's doing something and you're not participating in it. And so all of those things take us away from fact-based decision-making, where we make decisions based on facts, and we start to make decisions based on emotion. And the same thing happens when we're trying to choose just one of many different things. Maybe that, you know, you're trying to choose, for example, a hotel when you go on your summer vacation, right? And if you go on any travel website, there are so many choices that at some point we become overwhelmed. We can't even tell apart the different options we have. So we become overwhelmed and we move away from facts and deciding based on what we truly want to being emotional and overwhelmed and not being able to be analytical. And that's where all of these problems start with. This is a problem that has existed since the beginning of time. The difference now is that our lives are way more complicated than they used to be. And so therefore, you know, it used to be maybe 100 years ago that people made very difficult decisions like that, maybe once in a year. Whereas now it's like every day I'm dealing with overwhelming choice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. For us, it happens on a daily level. So I cannot choose what I want to eat, especially if I'm going scrolling through the application. So I'm not even hungry after 5 or 10 minutes.
I know. If we told our grandparents this problem, imagine you called your, you know, you're like, you went in a time machine to, you know, 100 years ago, and you're like, listen, so my big problem is I don't know what to have for lunch. People would be like, you know what? This is Serbia, like eat the national dish or whatever.
Yeah, sarma.
Yeah, exactly. And you're going to like it.
Yeah.
It's perfect moment to talk about FOMO. You put a big focus on this FOMO's evil sibling, FOBO, which stands for fear of better option. Is this fear more threatening than FOMO?
I love that question because I think for most of us it is. So FOBO, or fear of better options, is the idea that there's something better out there. And while we're trying to make a decision, you know, we say, for example, you're deciding between five things, you might be tempted to say, well, if I just keep looking, I'll find something even better. And so as a result, rather than deciding on things that are perfectly acceptable, you keep looking and looking and you never make a decision. And this happens in dating, right? I mean, I'm sure everybody watching who's single is on the dating apps, you know, swipe. And that is classic FOBO. You know, you go out with somebody, you're like, well, this person's very nice, but why don't I keep looking and swipe and go on a million more dates? And so that happens not just in dating, but in looking for a job and looking for an apartment and trying to pick a school and trying to decide where you're going on your vacation, all of, even just like, what am I gonna wear today, right? Mm-hmm. I do this too. The other night I was going to, so New York City, we've all been vaccinated, thankfully. And I was going to a small gathering at somebody's house. And I was like, wow, like, I have to put on clothes tonight, you know? And so, which was a new problem I hadn't had. And so I changed 4 times because I was like, I don't know, maybe something else. And I'm supposed to be the FOBO guy that overcomes these things. And the reason why FOBO is worse than FOMO is because FOBO tends to increase the older we get and the more successful we get. Because the more options you have, the more likely you are to feel FOBO. So it's very ironic that somebody who's really successful and has plenty of money and plenty of opportunities could end up being completely trapped And that's what happens with FOBO. So it's a really, I think it's much more destructive. The other thing is that we tend to, when we have FOBO, we don't just hurt ourselves, we hurt all the people around us. Because other people, say you're just trying to pick a restaurant to meet your friends at, and they're waiting for you, you are hurting all of them by not deciding and letting everybody just move on with their lives.
Yeah. Regarding this part with the fear of better option, and you mentioned earlier the dating, yeah? So let's talk about marriage, for instance, yeah? So living in a world of endless options. So we are dealing with the recent studies that are showing us that people are more tend to divorce, or at least are thinking about it, not because they are not happy, but because they could be happier. So what's your opinion on it?
Yeah, that's a, by the way, that I've never had that question. It's a fantastic question. And what's happening there is when we have FOBO, fear of a better option, there is a perception that somehow there's a better option out there for us. But the perception may not be true. Of course, perception is all based on, you know, things in your head. It's not necessarily based on reality. And in fact, perception can be deception. And so, you know, you're sitting here and you're with your husband or wife and you're like, oh man, you know, this person, they're, you know, they're sometimes they're cranky with me and they complain too much and they're this, that, and the other. I wish I had somebody, there's gotta be somebody out there who's better for me. You have no idea. And in fact, this happens all the time that people break up with people thinking they're going to find somebody better and they never do. And then they regret and they're like, why did I do that? And so it's important, you know, it may be, by the way, that you would be happier, but simply, you know, sort of if you don't do the work to figure out what would make you happy and whether there are people who could make you happy and then trying to find those people, I'm not saying to cheat on your spouse. I'm not recommending that, but that is the work that we need to do with FOMO and FOBO. We have to remove the emotion and go to the reality and think about the facts. And that allows us to make smarter and better decisions.
Yeah, I read a book actually recently that said that it's not easy, this thing that you're talking about, it's not easy because we are actually having with us, like she's calling it like the single bar in your pocket. So yeah. The bar for the single people, yeah, but in your pocket. So she says it's the divorces and breakups, etc., are inevitable just because of it. So it's so easy these days to see what you could have if you are not engaged, married, or something like that. So it is, yes. It is difficult. But
let's talk about business a bit.
We mentioned actually some bad aspects, yeah, bad aspects of FOMO. But when can actually FOMO be beneficial and helpful? And is there any chance that FOBO can help us also?
Ah, good questions. Okay, so on FOMO, yes, FOMO can be good. And the reason why is because FOMO allows us to maybe realize something that we do want to try. So for example, say you have a friend who starts a new entrepreneurial venture. And you feel FOMO, you feel all the FOMO in the world. Or you have a friend who runs a marathon and you have, and this happened to me, by the way, my friend ran a marathon and I was like, oh, I want to run a marathon. Oh my goodness. I just want to run a marathon. I don't know how or where or why, but I want to run a marathon. And so I said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to go run a marathon tomorrow because frankly, I have no idea if I will like it. And I have no idea if I can even do it. But you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to start running more than I did before and start building up to see if it's something I want to do. Mm-hmm. Same with entrepreneurship. I'm not going to quit my job and then start some company because I have no idea if I like it or no idea if I'll be good at it. But what I can do is start spending more time working on something. And my first book is called The 10% Entrepreneur, and it's all about this. It's the idea that in life, when we have things that give us FOMO, rather than just being suffering and being depressed about it or being frustrated, why don't we take a percentage of our time and energy and money and try that thing out and see if we even like it. And so if you like, for example, if you want to run, I think it's 42K as a marathon in Europe. Mm-hmm. If you want to run 42K, start with 10K and then get to 20 and then 30, and then you could run the whole thing. And that's what I did. If you want to be an entrepreneur, start with 10% of your time, work in it on the weekend and the evening. And then if you like it, spend more time and maybe even go full time. So that's the beauty of FOMO. FOMO is like a tap, tap, tap on the shoulder by the universe that is saying, you should figure out whether this is for you. Get rid of the perception that it's good and see if it really is. On the FOBO side, you know, I think about this a lot. This is a hard question. Is there something good about FOBO? I tend to think not. FOMO is like drinking wine. When you drink a little wine, you relax, you get in a dance floor, like, you know, that's kind of the tap on the shoulder. Maybe I should talk to that person. FOBO is like smoking cigarettes. It's bad for you and it's bad for the people around you. I mean, and it feels good. I mean, nobody, people don't smoke because it doesn't feel good. Of course it feels good. It's nice. But it's hurting you. So sorry for you smokers out there. I'm just saying it's not good. And so no, I don't think there's anything good about it. The one thing about it is that it's one of these things that people get very used to doing. And then one day they wake up and realize that everybody thinks they're a terrible person.
Okay. So nothing good about FOMO.
No FOMO. No FOMO. That's my goal for everybody. No more FOMO.
Okay. We understood.
Okay. What about the time when you, for example, decide to be an entrepreneur, to start a company, and you're both scared, enthusiastic, you're about to make so many decisions? I think you will be for sure in this loop of fears. So yes. How we can prevent getting into being in that loop of fears?
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And that's why, by the way, I am fearful of being an entrepreneur. It's funny. I've written a book about entrepreneurship. I'm terrified. So I never, you know, for me, it's sort of like, imagine the first time you put a baby in the ocean, right? You don't just put the baby, you don't just like, hey, baby. No, you put the baby like the little toes in, then maybe you sit the baby on the side and they get like, you're very gentle with the baby, right? As you should be with yourself. So I believe that the best way to think about entrepreneurship is starting slowly and then learning as you go. And there's a wonderful book called The Lean Startup, which I love, by Eric Ries, that sort of talks about that. So when I think about entrepreneurship, I think about, number one, starting slowly. Number two, don't do it alone. Having somebody there who can hold your hand, as it were, and help you. And number three, you know, being realistic about the fact that you may not even like it, and that's okay. Some people just aren't meant to be entrepreneurs. There's nothing wrong with it. It's scary. It's hard. You work all the time. You can put yourself in financial risk. And so it's important to recognize all of these things and accept that it's scary, and then say, okay, what can I do to get more comfortable? And for me, that's always starting part-time. I mean, I remember the first things I did as an entrepreneur, I spent a couple hours a week helping a friend with his startup. And then, you know, funny enough, that friend went on to raise some money. I invested a little bit of money in that company. And now that company is doing over $1 billion in revenue, and I'm an investor. So, I mean, I could have never seen that coming. It's absolutely crazy. But that's the beauty of starting small. I never had to worry about, you know, not being able to pay for my rent or my apartment or my food, all that sort of stuff. And so the beauty of that is, like anything else, whether it's running a marathon or any of the other things we've talked about, if you start small, you can build up to the point where you can run the whole marathon.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great advice, actually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We read also about your experience when you said that you lost a serious amount of time and money because of FOMO, and that you realized you need to change. So we would like to know, how are you feeling today?
Well, here's the thing. I recognize that FOMO is deep within me. Okay, it is. I'm actually right now, everybody, as you're watching, I'm actually in the house I grew up in. Okay, I grew up in the countryside in a very small village of 20,000 people. There was no FOMO because it's very quiet here. And then I went to college and university, and I went to Harvard and New York, and I was so excited at all the opportunity that I felt all the FOMO in the world. And I still do. For example, in 2021, vaccine FOMO, you know, when I was waiting for the vaccine and I would hear people getting it, I felt tons of FOMO. Now I want to go and, you know, try to restart my life, and I feel the FOMO. So I will always feel FOMO. When I'm like 1,000 years old in a nursing home, I'll have FOMO all day long. The difference is I recognize it's FOMO now. And when I feel the FOMO, I have the tools to deal with it. And so I think that's what I try to do with this book. And from what people tell me, having read it, it's helped them a lot, is that I recognize the fact that the world, the modern world, has lots of FOMO in it, whether it's, you know, the opportunities or just the fact that, you know, this phone in your hand is designed to give you FOMO, all the notifications, all the WhatsApps and everything. It's built to give you FOMO. Let's accept that, but then let's have the tools to manage it so that we can live better lives. That's so I feel pretty good, actually. I just meditated right before this interview, so I'm feeling
good. Great. You know how to balance it, and I think that's the most important part about it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So now, talking about the herd mentality, that's something that the chapter that I enjoyed, I think, mostly, because mm-hmm. it's really eye-opening. So you were talking about these impulsive shopping patterns, and for instance, Black Friday. Yeah, that's something that we are all familiar with. But tell me, you said that while your FOMO is still yours, to quote you, you never really stood a chance. So it's not completely up to us, yeah? We're not alone in this process. So how do you explain it? What did you mean by that?
Yeah, so what I meant by that, and it's funny, I was thinking about Black Friday. So that's all moved online now, right? It was when I wrote the book, you know, Black Friday was a physical thing. And then with the pandemic, it's gone online, which is kind of interesting. We'll see what happens. I think it'll be back. But you never really stood a chance. What I meant by that is that modern marketing is all based on FOMO. And so marketers use FOMO. I mean, you go onto any website and they'll have all these triggers, these nudges, like only three left, or, you know, save now, or don't miss out. I mean, the amount of emails I get that are from retailers to say, don't miss out. Bitcoin. The FOMO is used so much. So there's all these things that make us feel like we have, you know, we have to move now. And in fact, if you've ever read the book Influence by Robert Cialdini, which is a very, you know, it's the sort of the original book about marketing and influence. I just interviewed him for FOMO Sapiens, and he talks about FOMO all the time in the form of social proof, which is the idea that if everybody's doing this, you know, it must be wonderful. And then also scarcity value, the idea that, like, if you don't do it right now, it'll be gone. And so marketers use that all the time, like, oh, the Kardashians are buying this skin cream, like, you know, look at, you want to be like Kim, you should buy it. And then at the same time, but there's only 1,000 bottles, so you have to buy it right now or you won't get it. And so when I first invented FOMO, I didn't think about these things. I just was going based on my day-to-day life. It was very personal. But then as I researched the topic for the book, I realized, like, FOMO is everywhere. And once you recognize that, then you have the power to combat it.
Mm-hmm. That's really insightful. Cool. Mm-hmm.
In the book, you made a great correlation between FOMO and the uprising internet society, as you call it, always on society. And this young people, young generation, never live the day without an internet. And what if you have, like, one thing to teach them, what that would be?
All right, I have my number one tip. This is my number one tip, and it's so important. So I want everybody to, if you remember nothing from today, which I hope you remember something, but if you don't remember anything, just remember this. This should never come into your bedroom. Ever, ever, ever. So statistics show that more than 80% of people sleep with their phone in their bedroom. Now, why do they do that? The alarm clock. Alarm clock. It's like the famous Trojan horse where they roll the horse up and then all the soldiers come out and kill everybody. Your alarm clock on your phone is the Trojan horse that attacks your life. And so what I recommend people do is I put this in my kitchen, far away from my bedroom. And then I have just, actually I use Alexa. I say, you know, Alexa, wake me up at whatever time. Or you can have, if you don't like Alexa, it's not for you, you can just have an old fashioned alarm clock. But the beauty of that is, and I used to be a person who slept with my phone near my bed. I know of people who put it under their pillow, which I think is really, I mean, that there are so many reasons why that's bad. I don't, you know, we need to like just not do that. It's bad for, you know, the waves coming in your brain, probably. But the beauty is when I wake up in the middle of the night, which I do, I woke up last night, rather than look at the internet or my phone, I just simply laid there and was able to fall back asleep. Now I picked up my phone, I'd be up for another 2 hours.
Yeah, you're right. And I remember this part from the book, you're making fun of us who are using actually the phones as our alarm clocks. I was really laughing so hard.
We're going to continue promoting this. No phone in the bedroom.
No phone, yeah. Okay, so we actually understood it. Okay, so regarding the social media, so you posed this question out loud, a question that was somewhere in the air for some time now. So how is it possible that we are following dozens and hundreds of people, celebrities, influencers of so all sorts, and still those are the people that are, they don't have a clue about our existence. And more than that, more probably we will never be able to learn something from them, not because we are not capable of it, but because they are not providing us with it. They're actually just sitting, eating, changing clothes, taking selfies, etc., etc. So how do you explain this weird trend? But I need to confess, so guilty as charged, because I'm the one who is actually following those people, dozens and thousands of them. So I need to confess, yeah, for the sake of honest conversation.
Yeah, I do too. I mean, I follow like Emily Ratajkowski and Jennifer Aniston and all my crushes and everything. It's like, I know it's like Jennifer Aniston. I mean, if you're watching, I'm here, but you know, I don't think she knows about me. And that's the reality. It's so weird, right? Yeah. It's weird because you go on Instagram, and I had this was something like, I just one day thought about it. Cause like I was talking to somebody about this and it just came to me. I was like, you go on Instagram and you have your like friends from high school, your friends from college. Then you have like a celebrity. Then you have your mom. Then you have like another celebrity, and it's all mixed in. So it feels like, oh, like, you know, it's just all my friends, like Bon Jovi, he's my friend, whatever, you know, it's like, yeah. Djokovic, he's just good old, you know, Djokovic, you know, he's got 4 million followers or whatever, and he follows like 7 people, right? And I think in the book, I added up like the top influencers, just like, you know, Selena Gomez and Cristiano Ronaldo and, you know, Ariana Grande have like, you know, 350 million followers amongst them, but they collectively follow like 2,437 people. That's nuts. Okay. And then, I just think it's like, it's weird. We should accept that it's basically just an advertising channel the way TV is, and know that it's like, it's just know that, because I think it's important to remember that like, they don't know who you are. And so if you just need to remember, this is a very arm length thing. And what's interesting is Clubhouse. So I'm sure, have you guys been on Clubhouse yet?
Yes.
Yeah. So Clubhouse, right? You can be in a room with a famous person. You can be in the room with Elon Musk or whoever. And that's even crazier, because you feel like you're like, oh, I'm just at it. I'm with you. Elon's talking. We're together. But you're not. I mean, you're like, he's up there. You're like among the people. They're not going to call you on. Maybe they'll call you on stage. But like, it's even weirder because it feels even more personal. And it creates an illusion that you are with these people when you are not. So I think I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. I think it can be fine, but you just have to keep that in mind that this is all a construct, and you'll be okay. Mm-hmm.
So it is an illusion, yeah? So we can actually say that it's an illusion that we are close to these people, yeah? To these celebrities. And if I see what they're having for the breakfast and I choose the same thing, so it makes me closer to them, yeah?
Mm. Yes, exactly. It's an illusion of proximity, and which I think can be good when it's, you know, when it's something that's good for you or positive. If you're inspired by somebody to live a better life or to do something kind, that's wonderful. But I think back to like, you know, 75 years ago, not to pick on the smokers again, but all the celebrities smoked and they were like, made it look very glamorous. Or even now you see like, you see somebody on TV and they're smoking, you're like, wow, that kind of looks cool maybe. And that's, you know, that's not a good thing. So, you know, I think we just should recognize that these people are influencing us and we may not realize it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So First time when you diagnosed yourself with FOMO, what was the main emotion behind it? So was it guilt or shame or some sort of disappointment? What did you feel?
I just felt tired. I was exhausted all the time because I literally was everywhere at everything to the point where I just, you know, I was like exhausted all the time from trying to do everything. And I think, you know, I would have, when I, you know, I first came up with this idea when I was in school, in graduate school, I remember just being like, you know, wow, like last night I went to 7 parties. And I stayed, I mean, and I did. And I stayed at them for like 30 minutes apiece. And I was like, the minute I got there, I'd say hello to a few people and I'd be leaving. And like, that just feels, it's fun. It is fun, right? It's fun to do a million things and see a million people. But, you know, I wake up the next morning and I'm like, what did I achieve last night? Besides just like being everywhere. I didn't really have a good conversation with anybody. And frankly, I felt stressed the whole time about wondering if the place that I wasn't at was better than where I was. So I was that one who'd like look over your shoulder, like, oh, over there. I don't want to be that person. I think that it's okay to do that once in a while, but if you do that every day of your life, you know, you never really build anything real. So that was the feeling I had. It was like stress, but like being tired, but also recognizing I was kind of being a bit shallow.
Okay. Yeah, and we are now coming to my favorite topic, because I was trying to get to know myself better in this pandemic whole past year. So what is your opinion? Did this COVID-19 pandemic year develop more FOMO and FOBO behavior?
So this is what I think. It's a really fascinating question. So I think right before quarantine, so New York City went into quarantine in March. I think you guys probably had a different timeline. Europe was much earlier. But right before the quarantine, there was this FOMO around like, do you have enough food in your house? Do you have enough toilet paper? And the stores were empty, right? Yeah. And then people wanted to have that last dinner or last party or last whatever. In fact, like my friends and I, I guess I was so clueless, like the COVID epidemic was coming and we were just still like living normal life. And actually like we had a huge party with that. In retrospect, I was like, oh my God, why did we do that? Right. We just didn't know. I think it was just we were clueless. When we went into quarantine, really for the first time, I really thought FOMO died of COVID. And I remember just feeling that. And I saw it on Twitter. You know, FOMO is dead. The one thing about the pandemic is it killed the FOMO. Why? Because there was nowhere to go, right? But then we all brought our phones with us into the quarantine. And I think I spent more time online and on social media than I had ever in my life. And so I felt this kind of different FOMO. And then over time, I think FOMO became much more profound. It wasn't about parties. It was about like seeing your family. It was about going to the wedding or getting married and, you know, all the things we couldn't do. And so FOMO became something really deep about like, I can't live the life I'm supposed to live. I'm missing out on my own life. And now what I think is going to happen is FOMO has survived the coronavirus. And what we're going to see now is people coming out, you know, hopefully this summer, and they're going to be feeling a ton of FOMO and it's okay. And in fact, I think, the New York Times wrote last week that now FOMO is something to look forward to because it's a sign that life is back to normal. But I would encourage everybody to remember what you learned in pandemic, to write down what's important to you, what's not important to you so that you live more thoughtfully. Because I know it myself, like I'm going to have to control myself this summer and not go to, you know, every party and not go on every vacation and just remember the good things. I learned how to cook during the pandemic. I should cook at home more, you know, things like that. And so we got to take care of ourselves because this pandemic has served the purpose in teaching us what's important.
Yes, I think some of us really experience this YOMO or joy of missing out. Is that our final goal, final destination in your opinion?
So JOMO is... I have like an issue with JOMO. I mean, I think the idea is a good idea, but I think that it's like very if you truly had JOMO, you wouldn't even know, because you'd be like, what concerns me is when somebody posts on Instagram, like, I'm staying in tonight, JOMO, JOMO, JOMO. It's like, if you really had JOMO, why are you on Instagram? So I think that it's just, I think you want to get there, but not even know it. Sort of like if you ever meditate, or you know, you take like yoga classes or whatever, the place you want to get to with meditation is the point where you're completely detached from everything and you're just like disconnected and you're just in your kind of space. That's how you want to get to with JOMO. And so that's why I sort of think it's a little bit, sometimes I people like to say, oh, I'm feeling JOMO, but I'm like, well, if you really were, you wouldn't have to tell me that. So that's my thought on JOMO.
Yeah, I understand. And please tell us, is this decision-making process which you're teaching us in the book so important, and is it easy to learn?
It is important. So the whole point of this book, besides, you know, of course, explaining all this stuff, is to help you find the power to choose what you actually want and the courage to miss out on the rest. So again, with JOMO, JOMO is about missing out, but it isn't about choosing what you want. And knowing what you want and choosing it is so critical in a world of overwhelming choice. So, you know, it is very, it's easy to use, because once you start doing it, and in the book, I sort of lay out very specific strategies. Once you start doing it, you realize, wow, like my life just got a lot less complicated and it's a lot simpler for me every day. And so many of the decisions we make are so unimportant that when you start to realize, why am I spending time on this decision that's not important? You are free. You are liberated from the jail of indecision. And so these are all things, as I've talked to people who've read the book, they've started putting them into practice. And they're all based on research and psychology. They're very, very easy to learn. And I lay out everything step by step. So they're powerful. And I promise you, and I'd love to hear from readers. If you want to write me, you can find me. Tell me what you think. But yes, I think they're tried and true strategies that anybody can do.
Okay, great. So I didn't ask, did you get our book? Yeah, do you have it?
I do have the book, but I have it in my apartment in New York City. So I'm going to have to send you a selfie with the book. I got it at my apartment when I traveled this weekend, so I apologize.
Oh, it's nothing, but you promised. You will send us.
By the way, it's a beautiful book. I love it. I was honored. So I sent pictures to my Serbian friends, and you can see it behind you. It's absolutely beautiful. Yeah. And what's so interesting is you changed the way I spell my name, which I thought was very interesting.
Yeah. In Serbia, we are doing. It's like a grammatical rule. You know?
We had to.
Patrick McGuinness.
Okay, this was really a brilliant conversation. We really enjoyed it. So once again, thank you for your time, and thank you for letting us dig in a bit more into this topic. So we are really happy. We're happy to be your side-by-side companion into spreading this whole idea and the importance of this topic. So as a publisher, we can say that we can promise that we will continue spreading the importance of this decision-making process, and we will make it easier with your book and your advices. We actually cannot wait for your next book.
Yes.
Yeah. So
please write.
Hopefully it won't be too long until our next interview. So
yeah, next time we'll do it in Serbia.
Okay. So if you come in summer, you will visit Finesse. Yeah,
amazing. And not in the winter, I mean, yeah. All right, sounds good to me.
You are more than welcome. Yeah,
thank
more
you.
Than welcome here. Thank you so much.
Thank you
Patrick. So goodbye.